Hello, class 10th. Hope you all are fit and fine at your places and safe. Students, today in this video, I'm going to continue the same chapter, that is your transpiration in biology. Actually, in this video, I'm going to discuss the exercises of the chapter transpiration. As we have already discussed the complete chapter, so let's start the exercises of chapter transpiration. Now your question number one is, name the following. Permanent open pores in the bark of old woody trees are your lenticels. An apparatus used for measuring the rate of transpiration, that is your Gannon's photometer. A plant in which stomata are sunken, that plant is Nerium. An apparatus to compare the rate of transpiration in a cut shoot, that is your what? Gannon's photometer. Kidney-shaped cells present at the borders of stomata, that is your what? Guard cells. Respiratory openings found on the stem of woody plant, and answer is what? Lenticels. Lenticels are actually what? Permanent open pores in the bark of the old woody tree, and they are also called respiratory openings, because they open during daytime also and night time also. Exudation of sap from injured part of plant is called bleeding, and loss of water from injured part of plant is also called what? Bleeding. Now next question is, your given below are certain biological statements which are incomplete and hence incorrect. Rewrite the correct form of the statement by inserting suitable word or words at right place, and do not delete any word already given in the statement. Okay. Now, so first is your transpiration is a loss of water from the leaves of a plant. Which word you will use here? The transpiration is the loss of water in the form of water vapor. Right. Second is your, the opening and closing of stomata is controlled by the turgidity of the guard cells. What, which word will come here? By the turgidity of the guard cells. Now more transpiration occurs from the dorsiventral leaf. So which surface? From the lower surface of dorsiventral leaf. Gutation is a loss of water in the form of droplets along the margins of the leaves. Bleeding is the exudation of sap or watery solution from the injured parts of the plant. Understood. Now next question is your comment upon the following. Plants have to pay the price of photosynthesis in the form of transpiration. Plants have to pay the price of photosynthesis in the form of transpiration. And why? Because stomata are primarily meant for the diffusion of carbon dioxide, which is to be used for photosynthesis. Right? But when carbon dioxide diffuses in, at the same time, a large amount of water is lost due to transpiration. So we can say that the plants have to pay the price of photosynthesis in the form of transpiration. Now, second is your transpiration is a necessary evil. Now, comment on this sentence. Transpiration is a necessary evil. Actually, leaf anatomy is designed by nature to facilitate or help in gases exchange for photosynthesis and respiration, right? But transpiration, however, become unavoidable, especially under conditions of deficit water supply. It becomes a serious problem. It thus appears that transpiration has been forced on the plants, and plants have to bear it even if they have to spend a lot of energy on it. And Curtius therefore rightly said that transpiration is a necessary evil. Now third is your, some plants shows wilting of their leaves even when the soil is well watered. Actually, wilting results from the flaccid conditions of leaf cells. When the amount of water loss through transpiration exceeds or become more than the amount of water absorbed through the roots. Next is your, a higher rate of transpiration is recorded on windy days rather than on calm day. And what's your answer? Actually, when the leaves are exposed to the winds of moderate velocity. Actually, the water vapors will not be allowed to accumulate in the vicinity of the leaves, and it will lead to increased rate of transpiration. First question number 11. The diagram shown below is an apparatus used to study a particular phenomenon in plants. Now, first question is your name the apparatus. So, what is the name of this apparatus? It is Ganong's potometer, right? And what is it used for? To measure the rate of transpiration. This Ganong's potometer is used to measure the rate of transpiration. Now, third question is your what is the role played by the air bubble in this experiment? So, what is the answer is the rate of water uptake can be calculated by timing the air bubble movement over a fixed distance on the scale. Actually, this air bubble is used to calculate the rate of water uptake by timing the air bubble movement over a fixed distance on the scale. Right? Now, next is your of what use is the reservoir? Actually, this is your reservoir. So, what is the use of this reservoir? It is used to bring back the air bubble to its original position by releasing water into the capillary tube by opening the stopcock of the water reservoir. Now, next question is your what happens to the movement of air bubble if the apparatus is kept versus in the dark? When the apparatus is kept in the dark, the air bubble will not move. Why? Because tomatoes are closed in the dark. Second is your in sunlight, what's happened? The air bubble moves at a faster rate because in sunlight, tomatoes they are open, right? In front of fan, the air bubble moves fastest. Why? Because moving air easily removes water vapor from the surface of the leaves. Understood. Now, next question is your the apparatus shown here is a Garus potometer designed to demonstrate unequal transpiration from the two surfaces of dorsiventral leaf. Before keeping the leaf in between the cups, anhydrous calcium chloride contained in two small vials. Actually, you will take these two vials. Right, and in these two vials, what you will take anhydrous calcium chloride, and take their weight, and then place in both the cups. The ends of the cups were closed with a cord through which two mercury manometers were connected. Right. Okay, now, so after a few hours, calcium chloride vials were taken out and weighed again. So, what is the purpose of keeping calcium chloride vials inside the cups? So, what's your answer? Anhydrous calcium chloride absorbs water vapors released during transpiration through the leaf surface. Now, second is your after a few hours, calcium chloride vials were taken out and weighed again. Will you expect any difference in weight? If so, gives reason. Actually, after a few hours, when you will take out these calcium chloride vials, what you will observe that both the vials have, there is a difference in their weights. Why? Calcium chloride vial facing the lower surface to the leaf, it weighs more than the calcium chloride vial facing the upper surface of the leaf. Why? Because lower surface transpire more as compared to upper surface. Understood. Next is your what is the purpose of the using manometer? Your answer is manometer is used to maintain the vapor pressure of the bell jar. Actually, if the mercury level changes then it indicates that apparatus is not airtight, or the pressure vapor released from the leaf surface is not completely absorbed by the calcium chloride. So this is the purpose of using mercury manometer, to maintain the vapor pressure of the bell jar. So manometer is used to maintain the vapor pressure of the bell jar. Now next question is, you are given below is a diagram of the of an experimental setup to study the process of transpiration in plants. Study the same and then answer the question that follows. Now here, what is the color of dry cobalt chloride paper? All of you know what is the color of the dry cobalt chloride paper. It is what? Blue. Right? Is the experimental leaf monocot or dicot? Just look at here. This leaf is showing reticulate venation. So the leaf is dicot. Give reason, because it is showing, the leaf is showing which venation? Reticulate venation. What it is showing? Reticulate venation. That is why it is dicot leaf. While monocot leaves always shows parallel venation. Now it is your, why are glass slides placed over the dry cobalt chloride papers? Your answer is, so that cobalt chloride paper could not come in contact with the water vapor present in air. Otherwise what's happen? They will turn pink when they come in contact with the water vapor present in the air.
Right? Otherwise, you will not get a proper result under experimental conditions.
Now, next is your, after about half an hour, what change, if any, would you expect to find in the cobalt chloride paper placed on the dorsal and ventral sides of the leaf? Give a reason to support your answer. So, what you will observe after half an hour? Cobalt chloride paper fixed on the lower surface of the leaf turns more pink as compared to the one that is fixed on the upper surface, because loss of water from the lower surface is more than the upper surface of the leaf. Understood? Means the cobalt chloride paper which is fixed on the lower surface, it will turns more pink as compared to the the one that is fixed on the upper surface of the leaf, because there are more stomatas on the lower surface as compared to the upper surface. So more loss of water takes place from lower surface as compared to the upper surface. Understood? Now next question is, your, the diagram given below represents a structure found in a leaf. Study the same and answer the question that follows. Okay, and first is your, name the parts labeled A and B. What is A? A is your guard cell. And A is guard cell and B is stoma. What is it? Stoma. What is the biological term for the above structure? And what it is called? Now third is your, what is the function of the leaf part labeled A? A is your what? Guard cell, and it help in opening and closing of stomata. Right? Next is your, fourth part of this question is, mention two structural features of A which help in the function mentioned in third above. Means, what are the two structural features of guard cells which help in opening and closing of stomata? So what's your answer? The opposing inner walls of guard cells are thickened and inelastic, and outer walls are thin and elastic. Right? Second is your, guard cells, they contain chloroplasts, and that's why in this way what they help in opening and closing of stomata. Actually the inner just look at here, the guard cells, the inner wall of the guard cells, especially in the middle, they are thickened, and that's why they are what? Inelastic. While remaining rest of the what wall of this guard cell, it is thin and it is elastic, and that's why, but when they are fully turgid with water, when they are fully filled with water, or when they become turgid, then they stretch out and the stoma open. And when these guard cells become flaccid, or when flaccid means when no more water is left in the guard cells, then these elastic walls they collapse and the stoma closed. Right? In this way the guard cells, they help in closing and opening and closing of stomata. Now where the is this structure likely to be found in leaf? The guard cells are found on the epidermis of the leaf or surface of the leaf. right? Or you can say epidermal surface of the leaf. The upper structure helps in process of transpiration. Explain the term transpiration. You can easily explain what is transpiration. Is a loss of water in the form of water vapors from the aerial parts of the plant. Now next is your, how many other cells are found surrounding this structure as seen in diagram? These are five other cells are there found surrounding the structure as seen in the diagram. Just five structures. Which one? 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 cells. Understood?